this lab today and this afternoon are in the cerebral hemispheres. Mr. Gardner will be doing most of the internal sections of the cerebral hemispheres. Myself and Dr. Lodak will be just reviewing the external features of the lobes of the cerebrum. If you remember, in the cerebral hemispheres, we have gray matter in two areas. We have gray matter on the cortex, and we have the deep, can't hear me? We have the deep nuclei of the forebrain, the deep nuclei of the forebrain, which are really the basal ganglia. And as you'll find out, basal ganglia is really a misnomer, because it's supposed to be basal nuclei. The ganglia are really, by definition, cell bodies that are outside of the central nervous system. Right? So for example, the dorsal root ganglia, sympathetic ganglia, but there they call them basal ganglia, or basal nuclei. What I'm going to do first of all is to just go over how we're going to divide the cortex into different areas, and we're going to talk about the functions of the different areas. The most important thing is being able to find this sulcus, which everybody knows by now is what? Central sulcus. Not that easy to find, okay? It might look simple to you here, right? But not that easy to find. Usually, the frontal gyri, they're going anterior posteriorly, and the two precentral and central and precentral, the three frontal gyri, and the precentral gyrus and the postcentral gyrus, they're going transversely. Right? So you can see them there. Sometimes when I can't really locate it, I cheat a little and I look over on the medial aspect of the brain. I'll show you on this one here, where we can actually see, this is called a paracentral lobule. Well, you can see this formation here, quite distinct, paracentral lobule. That paracentral lobule is going to lead you into the central sulcus, right? Okay. Okay, so we're going to have a precentral gyrus and a postcentral gyrus. Now, another way that I find it sometimes is that I will start at the beginning of the lateral sulcus, right? So this is the lateral sulcus here, or the Sylvian sulcus, okay? And I will start at its origin, which is right at this point. This area is called, Mr. Gardner told you before, it's called the valicular cerebrum, the valley of the cerebrum, right here. Sorry, there we go. And what we see coming up there, right there, is what? The internal carotid artery, right, okay? That area, right, where I'm going into there now, that's where the anterior perforated substance is. Anterior perforated substance is right anterior to, this is the optic nerve, optic chiasm, and this is the optic tract starting here. So right anterior to the optic tract there, that's where you're. So that's the point we call it valicular cerebellum. You also have a valicular cerebelli here in the cerebellum. So if we continue here, remember the middle cerebral artery is going to go that way. If we come laterally now, we're going to see three rami. Alright? And if we look at this point, that's where they are. This is the ascending ramus. So this is the posterior ramus. This one going here, which becomes the, which is continuous as Sylvian sulcus, right? Okay. We have ascending ramus and an anterior ramus. All right. Let me just get that right again. This is the ascending ramus and the anterior ramus. All right. So this area, right here. This area is called a pars. Anybody knows? Opercularis, okay? This area, triangular area is a pars triangularis. And this area, pars orbitalis. Alright, okay? And we know that the posterior two areas here are what? Well, Broca's area, not on this side, but on this side. Okay? on the left side. Okay, so here we see again, this is the tree rim right here, seen much better. This is the pars opercularis here, it's broken a little. But you can see that? Alright, okay. This is the ascending ramus, and this is the anterior ramus, the posterior ramus. This is, anybody know, heard of a guy by the name of Corbinian? Corbinian, what's his last name, Patrick?
Patrick,
sir. Yeah. Anyhow, this is Broadman, Corbinian Broadman. We have Broadman. So we have Broadman's area, this is Broadman's area 44, and Broadman's area 45. You don't have to know them all, but a few you have to know, right, okay? 44 and 45, yeah. Okay? So I'm getting ahead of myself. Because if I find this area, then I know that behind the pars opercularis, the next gyrus I'm seeing here is the precentral gyrus. Alright, okay? So that's maybe what I'm trying to tell you. You can have a look here, and this is the central sulcus. But if you want to be certain, you just check on the medial surface and you see the paracentral gyrus. Or you can go to where the tree rami are and you just go posteriorly to that, and that's the precentral gyrus. No. The frontal lobe has three sulci. And what I do is that if we put your two fingers these two fingers on the precentral and postcentral gyrus. Just imagine the gyri are my fingers and the sulci are the spaces between my fingers. Eh? So this is the central sulcus here. Central sulcus here. With the precentral gyrus and the postcentral gyrus. If we look anteriorly now, if you put our three fingers going down here, right, you're going to see basically a superior frontal gyrus, a middle frontal gyrus, and an inferior frontal gyrus. And in between, as you say, sometimes you wonder where they are, but if you really look, you will see that the superior sulcus continues. You know, along from the anterior to this area. Here would be the inferior sulcus, so we have three gyri, right? The superior frontal gyrus, middle frontal gyrus, and the inferior frontal gyrus, right? I'm going to come back to this, right? Talk a little bit more about it, but I'm just going to show you how we divide the lobes, eh? Now, the lateral sulcus, here, separates the temporal lobe from the parietal lobe. Posterior to the postcentral gyrus, right here, this one, right, okay, is the parietal lobe. And the lateral sulcus separates the parietal lobe from the temporal lobe. Right? If we come to the temporal lobe now and we put three fingers on, right, we can see three gyri. Superior temporal gyrus, a middle temporal gyrus, and an inferior temporal gyrus. We have two sulci, superior temporal sulcus, and an inferior temporal sulcus. Now, to delineate the posterior aspect of the parietal lobe, right, we have to find two areas. We have to look, if we look medially, it's easy to delineate it, right? Because we have a parieto occipital sulcus right here, which is going to separate them, right? And the calcarine sulcus coming right down, parieto occipital calcarine sulcus. But laterally now, we have to find an imaginary line. And that imaginary line is going to be between the superior part of the parieto occipital sulcus. So sometimes you have to look over again, and here it is. Right, so that's the superior part, that's right here, superior part of the parietal occipital sulcus. And we find an imaginary line now between that and an indentation, right, okay, on the in front of the occipital pole of the brain, and that's called the preoccipital notch. Now what makes that preoccipital notch? Anybody knows? Sorry? Petrous temporal bone. I'm not so certain the petrous temporal bone or the superior surface of the temporal cerebelli at that point. point and does it really, right? Okay, because some books say actually they tend to cerebelli, it's domed up there and makes that pre-orbital notch, okay? But it's a notch that's there definitely, and if we go right across, that will delineate the posterior aspect of the parietal lobe. Now, if we continue up now along the lateral fissure to that, right? To that imaginary line, then that will delineate the parietal lobe from the temporal lobe posteriorly, and the temporal lobe posteriorly from the occipital lobe. Everybody understand that? Okay, yes. We went over that before, all right, okay? So today, what I'm really going to be doing is the superior lateral side of the cerebrum, and Dr. Lodenke this afternoon is going to do the inferior aspect. We have three views, a superior lateral view, an inferior view, and a medial view. So there's a medial view here, and the inferior view would be along here. So I might get on to the medial aspect, or I might leave that for Dr. Lodenke. All right? Now, so we spoke about the three gyri in the frontal lobe, right, on the superior lateral surface. We spoke about the three gyri in the temporal lobe. Now, how the parietal lobe divided? Anybody know how many gyri are there? Two lobules, right? Two lobules, okay? So if we look, this is the posterior aspect of the parietal lobe, and we look down the middle here, we see a sulcus. And what's that called? Anybody can tell me? The intraparietal sulcus, which is going to separate this whole area, which is called the superior parietal lobule, from this area down here, which is the inferior parietal lobule. Right? Now, superior parietal lobule does go onto the median side of the brain. Alright, okay? Alright, so all this area, which is the precuneus, right, okay? All this is superior parietal lobule. Okay? Alright, on the median side. Now, the two areas that I should point out, right, laterally. If we follow the lateral sulcus right back, that will be here, there's a cut made here by the pathologist, that is, they do make those cuts for when they're taking specimens from the brain. So if we follow this right back, right, okay, this is the lateral sulcus. Then at the posterior aspect of the lateral sulcus, this area above here, anybody know what that's called? Called the supramarginal gyrus, supramarginal, that's Brodmann era 40, right, okay? Supramarginal gyrus. I'm going to be talking a little about the functional of these areas, okay? So this is supramarginal. If we follow now the lateral sulcus, the sulcus of Sylvia, this area posteriorly here, this would be the supramarginal gyrus, okay? And if we follow the superior temporal sulcus, when we come back here, this part posteriorly here is the angular gyrus. All right, okay? That's Brodmann's era 39. All right? Okay? All right, so that's just a rough. I'm not going to go into the other areas. As I said, I'm not going to have a lot to tell you this afternoon. But I'm going to start by talking about the functional thing of these different areas, right? Okay, so first of all, we're going to start with this area, right? Okay, and this, what we're looking at here is what? The precentral gyrus, okay? Precentral gyrus, right? Which goes all the way back onto this part here of the paracentral lobule, okay? Paracentral lobule, okay? And then post-central would be on this side, going right down into it here, okay? All right, so this is called the primary motor cortex. The cortex is divided into two areas. You have primary cortex, right, okay, and secondary cortex. Secondary cortex is called association cortex. Primary cortex is not just for motor, but also for sensory. So you have somatosensory cortex. You have special senses like audition, taste, hearing, right, and then so those are the primary cortex, okay? The association cortex now are the other areas. So today I'm going to be telling you, I'm going to start with the primary motor cortex, And then I'm going to talk about the area in front, which we call the premotor cortex, and then the association cortex of the frontal lobe, which is the prefrontal cortex. You say about 25% of the brain is primary cortex, and about 75% is association cortex. Anybody tell me what association cortex, what it does? Planning and I would put it in one thing, I say cognition, right? Cognition is awareness, right? Okay? You're aware of what's around you. And when you ask somebody for a definition for cognition, they say, okay, it's awareness or knowledge of. It's probably a little bit more than that. And I'd like to give you a good definition, okay? I have a definition of cognition, which is that where you receive appropriate stimuli, and you're going to neural processes, right? Where you're going to integrate stimuli with knowledge, right? Memory of that stimuli, and sort of your internal motivation, what will motivate you, right? About a stimulus like that. And you come up with what I call a perceptual awareness or planned behavior. Okay, so all of that is what I would regard as cognition. And a lot of that goes on in the secondary cortex. So that's receiving stimuli, right? Okay, and so and have a knowledge, memory of that of the stimulus, and also using your internal motivations to come up with an awareness of what that stimulus means. All right, okay. Now, the primary cortex receives things directly, like the motor cortex is going to project to the corticospinal tracts. Okay, but the sensory cortex, they're going to be getting things from the sensory receptors in your body. But in the association cortex, most of the fibers come from other areas. So for example, frontal cortex, prefrontal cortex, you're going to get a lot of fibers from the occipital cortex. So most of those fibers that come to the association cortex are coming from other cortices. Right, okay? Okay, so let's start with the primary area, prefrontal cortex. Alright? Now, when I was a student, we were told it was much simpler. Didn't know that much about the brain then. Okay, so I've had to do a lot of reading. But in those days, we were told that almost all of the corticospinal and corticonuclear tract originated in the precentral gyrus, right? We now know that that's not the case. So what percentage of them come to start here? Anybody know? Professor Lobot has told you many times. About a third, right? The others are from the premotor area, and some actually start in the sensory area. So one third from the precentral gyrus. About a third comes from the premotor area, and after another third from the sensory cortex, the somatosensory cortex of the postcentral gyrus. Now, the other thing also is that these corticospinal and corticonuclear tracts that start from the primomotor cortex, they usually start in the pyramidal cells of Betts. Anyone can tell me what layer those are in?
Five.
Yeah, five, all right, okay? The pyramidal cells of Betts. And they don't just target specific muscles. They're targeting movement more than muscles, all right, okay? So they're areas that are going to control movement, right? They're going to control a specific muscle then, all right, okay? So, what is a homunculus? Anybody knows? What does homunculus mean? Anybody knows? Well, homunculus really means little man. That's what it means, little man. Right? So we have a little man that's going to start here, and he's going to bend over, right? Okay. At his hips, in a position, Dr. Lenski calls up
630.
630, we call it. Okay, 630. Right? Right, Dr. Lenski. 630. One of his better moves in the kitchen, Dr. Lenski, on the floor. He's very good at the 630.
He's been trying
to teach JP, but JP is not a
what? What is
Alright, So if we go now, the foot will be here, right? So if we have a, if we have an infarct in this area, what would you expect? Paralysis is where?
Lower.
In the lower limb or the foot in this area. And as we go up the leg, Dr. Lenke mentioned this morning, the perineal area, right in this area, immediately. But this whole area here is the buttock, right? Okay, the buttock area right here. One of the things about the precentral area is that we see disproportional representation. What does that mean?
Some
parts are much bigger, right? Okay. The trunk just only has... The trunk just only have a little area here. And this whole big curve here, what is that dedicated to? Anybody knows?
The hand.
The hand and the upper limb, right? This whole big curve here is the upper limb, okay? And then as we come down here, what?
Face.
Face, right? Okay, right, okay? So disproportionately, the trunk is disproportionately represented in this, okay? All right, now, what does happen? Where does the prefrontal, where does the premotor cortex end, and where does the prefrontal cortex? Students always have a little trouble with that. Anybody knows? Well, there's really no way of, but if we look here, this is the precentral sulcus, and there's the postcentral sulcus. There's the central sulcus, precentral sulcus, postcentral sulcus, okay? If we put out three fingers from the front, right, this is about the posterior third of those gyri is where the premotor cortex is, right? So the posterior one third, and the anterior two thirds is what? Prefrontal cortex. So now you know it's not an exact measurement, it's an approximation, created basically about one third to two thirds, okay, in the prefrontal cortex. Now what does the premotor cortex do? Anybody knows? Yeah. Well,
perception.
More sequencing of the movements, really, than anything else, okay? It used to be thought that it was some higher level of functioning, but we now know it's more, it aids the prefrontal cortex and the motor cortex, and it's actually more involved with sequencing of movement. The books will tell you that laterally, right, is the premotor cortex, and medially it's the supplementary motor cortex. Right, okay? Nowadays I think we don't use that too much again, JP. It's medially seem to be more involved with more bilateral coordination of bilateral activity, bilateral movements of the limbs and things like that, medially and the rest. So it really assists the motor cortex, and also a lot of the cortical, one third of the cortical spinal tracts and the cortical nuclear fibers come from that area, right, okay? So the premotor cortex. Now what about the prefrontal cortex now? What's the function of that? Anybody knows? Yeah, we divide it again into two parts. Huh? We have the dorsolateral part, and we have the orbitomedial part. So we have the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex and the orbitomedial, dorsolateral and orbitomedial. They're involved in decision making, like executive decision making. Okay, so all of our, but there's a slight difference. There's a difference between them. The superior lateral prefrontal cortex is involved in decision making. This is the place that really seems to be the root of our what we call working memory. And working memory is, if we're doing a task, we continue to do it. People who have lesions in that area, they can't finish anything. So they start looking for a set of keys and a little way they forget about it. But holding that working memory in that area, that's a function of the dorsolateral area. While the orbitomedial, right, is more involved with what? Anybody knows? You haven't had the lectures yet? But the limbic system, right? The limbic system. Yeah, we seem to make more advantageous life decisions, like are we going to earn enough money to support our children? We're going to stop drinking, stop going to Apollo at night. So you need more money to send your kids to school. That sort of thing. Apollo is where they're going better at night. So that's sort of this more advantage, whereby this is an executive function. The whole thing is executive function, but this area is more for working memory, and this is more involved with the limbic system. All right. Okay, we come now to So this is the area we're talking about, this orbitomedial, which Dr. Lodek will be telling a bit more about this afternoon because he's going to do the inferior part of the brain. And going on to the medial part of the brain, of the forebrain there, that would be the orbitomedial part, and this part would be the dorsolateral part. Okay? Now when we come posteriorly now to the parietal area, we have the, first of all, we have the post-central gyrus, okay? So the pre-central gyrus, post-central. Oh yes, sorry. Two very important things that I say, but I have to have a key. There are two parts of the frontal lobe that I should be stressing more. And one is in the medial posterior part of the medial frontal gyrus, and one is the posterior part of the inferior, huh? The middle. Middle frontal gyrus, and one is the inferior frontal gyrus, and medial. Middle frontal gyrus, inferior frontal gyrus. We've already covered this area, right? Which on the left side, what is it? Pars orbicularis and pars triangularis. Broca's? 44-45, that's Brodmann's area, 44-45. What will happen if you have a lesion here? Expressive aphasia, okay? And when it comes to the temporal lobe, which I'm hoping to get in today, right, okay? Right, then expressive aphasia. Now, there is another area now. This is really in the part, this is really in the area of the premotor cortex, the posterior part of the middle gyrus, right about here. So in the inferior gyrus, this is inferior here, and this is the middle, right? Okay. So about this area is the frontal eye field. That's Brodmann era what? 8. By the way, the pre-central gyrus and Brodmann era what? Pre-central gyrus 4, and the premotor cortex is what? 6. All right. Okay. We're not going to go into the prefrontal cortex. You don't need to know that. Just need to know the important ones. Okay. All right. The frontal eye field is what? 8. All right. Okay. That's in the middle right here, right? And this is involved with conjugate eye movements, moving your eyes from left to right, which we do all day long. I'm looking at that lovely young lady over there, another lovely young lady over there. And I'm moving my eyes from side to side, okay? How do we do that? This is the area that controls that. Well, what you're going to do, and you haven't gotten there, but this area is going to control movements of the eyes to the left side is going to control the movements of the eyes to the right. Right? And the right side is going to control the movement of the eyes to the left. Right? How does it do that? It's going to send impulses. You saw an area today that Dr. Lubutan showed you. In all three specimens, he had what? Near to the center of the center of the of all the sections, the median, longitudinal, and circulus. Anybody know what that does? Yeah, it connects the nuclei for the extraocular muscles of the eye, which is 3, 4, and 6. Now you're going to do that. So I don't want to go into it in detail, all right? But what there's another area adjacent to that now in the pons called the paramedian pontine reticular formation, PPR, right? Okay. And that's going to send impulses to the PPRF, which is going to stimulate, this is just, you're going to do this again, which is going to stimulate the abducens nucleus on the right. That's going to move. The right lateral rectus. At the same time, that abducens nucleus has a connection with the left turnal, special nucleus in the left turnal, the oculomotor nucleus. Right, okay, because the turnip has different nuclei from different eye muscles. So let's move on. So there's a special nucleus there that's going to move the medial rectus. And that's going to send an impulse from the abducens nucleus to the nucleus that moves the right median rectus on the left eye, and the eye is going to shift to the right. And that's something we do all day long. Same thing is going to happen on the left side. The left side is going to move. Right, okay. And when you do the eye next week, we're going to be doing all that. All right, okay. So that's the frontal eye. All right, okay. I know it's almost midday, and I don't want to I don't want to leave too much for Dr. Lemmy this evening, so I'm going to just do the part alone. All right? Okay?
Yeah, you don't have one eye.
Let's take it post central gyrus now. Right, okay? Again, there's a similar homunculus, right, okay? That represents, this is the area for the somatic sensory cortex. Somatic sensory cortex, okay? Right, primary somatic sensory cortex. So this is going to receive impulses from what tracks, ascending tracks? What tracks are going to come? They're going to come through the thalamus and go come to that area. You're going to get sensation. What is the sensation you're going to get from the body? You have light touch, discriminative touch, vibration sense, conscious proprioception. That's coming up in what track?
Dorsal
column, medial limb discus. Then we have pain and temperature and crude touch. That's going to come in the anterior and lateral spinal calamitra, which we tend to combine today and call them the what? Anterolateral system. They're going to come up, one is going to cross, which one is going to cross in the spinal cord? Anterolateral. Which one is going to cross in the middle? The dorsal column, okay? And then the dorsal column is going to run up with the medial limb discus. What nuclei in the thalamus are they going to go through? ATL. Now, are you fully aware that there's a similar system for the face, right? Okay? The head, what is that called? Trigeminal. Right? So you have all those impulses coming to the trigeminal system, and that trigeminal system is going to go to what nucleus? The impulses in the trigeminal system. We haven't done that yet. They're going to go to the VPM. Right? That's the nucleus in the thalamus. We haven't done the thalamus yet. All right, okay? So they're going to receive all the primary sensations that are coming from the body in this, okay? And they're going to process those information. A lot of it is going to process where? Posterior to it. What we call the area posterior? Posterior parietal cortex. And that's divided into a superior and an inferior lobule. Right? Now a lot of that, the association cortex for this, for the primary sensory cortex, is in the posterior parietal cortex. Okay? And if you have lesions here, right, in this area, then one of these things they're going to ask you when you go to the hospital, they're going to give you a triangle or a square, and they put it in your pocket or put it in your hand with your eyes closed, and they ask you to identify it. If you can't identify that, what do you call it?
Asterognosis.
What is gnosis? Knowledge, right? So we have gnosis, right? Everybody knows how to spell gnosis? G-N-O-S-I-S. So if we don't have gnosis or knowledge or whatever, what? Agnosis. But agnosis today is used mainly for what? It's about the agnostic. What?
Don't believe in God.
Don't believe in God. That's much more than that, okay? But in the cerebral hemisphere, we have specific areas that you'll have agnosis for. Alright? Okay? So, what I'm going to tell you about is called anosognosis. Alright? And the other one, Dr. Lenke is going to tell you about this evening, it's called prosognosis. Alright? So I'm just going to talk a little about the posterior parietal cortex. So in addition to being the association area for the sensory somatosensory cortex, which is the post central gyrus, this area especially in the inferior part of the parietal lobule, right, okay, is where we have our attention, where we pay attention to a world around us, to the right and left eye fields. Actually, when the visual processing is done in the occipital lobe, you're going to have further processing done in two areas, one in the inferior temporal lobe, where we recognize things, the what era. So we're that's where we're gonna see our faces and recognize our faces. Okay. So although you're seeing from the way you think from here, your recognition now is in these areas. In the inferior temporal lobe, you're going to have the what era. Here is the sort of where era. Movements, like you see movements or where things are going, what that where are we, where around us, what it is, and this is sort of area which will identify all of, especially the inferior parietal lobule. Now that inferior parietal lobule on the do we know anything about sightedness in the brain? Sightedness? Well, we've seen a couple of examples already, yeah? We have most people broke speech areas where?
Left.
Yeah, area for audition is where? Left, right here, which is that area called? That's auditory, primarily auditory cortex, and we've seen it right there. That's pistol gyrus right along here, these transverse gyrus right along here. Right? And that's Bodman's era. Body knows? 41. Okay. Anyhow, I don't want to get to the temporal lobe yet. Let me just finish the part. Alright, okay? So, in this area, we have a vision of our world around us, okay? Now, we have sightedness on the right side. Right here on the right parietal cortex, posterior parietal cortex, we can actually see both our visual fields, right side and left side. But on the left side, we can only see the right visual field. Right, so we have sightedness on the right for visual fields. Although you'll find when you do the vision that our right occipital cortex will see our left field, and our left will see our right field. But in the association cortex here, we see both fields on the right. So what on the left side, you're going to see the left field. So what will happen if you have a stroke on the right ear? No, yeah, but you still have the left side. So you can't really see anything on your left visual field. What will happen there is that you start neglecting. You should start neglecting. You get caught or neglect on the left side of the body. You ask somebody to draw that brain, and they draw the right side of the brain. They don't draw the left side of the brain. Literally, right? They just can't visualize what's happening on the left side, okay? Okay? Only they can actually see it. They just can't. They can't comprehend it, right? Okay? So they're caught or neglect the left side of the body. So that happens. So that's something to read up about. And also, that's called anosognosia. Well, anosognosia is a little bit more than that. Usually, along with the stroke, you're going to have a paralysis on the other side. And that is when they're going to completely disown the left side of the body.
Yeah.
So the paralyzed side, they're going to disown it completely. That's what it's called, anosognosia. Right, okay. So it's something worth reading up about, and I'm certain Professor Lobotan will be telling more about that. It's the inferior parietal lobule, right? We see our visual fields, and we see where we are in this world, and our body image also, right, okay? So not just association for the sensory, for the primary sensory cortex, but also there's visual association cortex here also, especially in the inferior aspect, all right? And there's two particular areas that Dr. Lobotan may have told you about, and Mr. Gardner told you about. One is the supramarginal, the angular, anybody know the syndrome that's associated with the angle, with infarct of the angular gyrus? Remember Professor Lobotan told you before? It's called Gerstmann syndrome. Remember it? That seemed to be the area that we calculate numbers and all that sort of thing. Okay, so we can't add it. We can't write. Can't add, we calculate, we get finger agnosia, we can't control fingers, and we have different, we have problems differentiating right and left side, right? Right and left side of our bodies, okay? So that is it. Those are the symptoms of achalcia, agraphia. graphically they can't write, because they can't add fingers, nose here, right? They can't count the fingers, you don't know which is their index finger, which is your middle finger. Okay? The brain's a very fascinating thing, really, and I tell you, you should read a little bit outside of the box, right? Not just the lectures you're getting, but read up a little about it, okay? Supramarginal teres again, also very important. That seemed to be a language error, right? Okay. Now, where is our language center? Wernicke's error, right? Okay. Now that seemed to go on to not just in the temporal lobe, but also go on to the supramarginal and the angular teres also. So all that error is Wernicke's error, right? Okay. Now, for most of us, which is our language? Which is our language area? Left side or right side?
Left
side. Now, women are a little bit different. Do you know that women seem to have bigger corpus callosum than men?
Can I have a chat now?
They have more connectivity between the right and left. My wife always tells me that I can't multitask. Eh? I always tell her I can only do one thing at a time, but whatever I do very well. Can multitask. So, and it's thought that they have more contact between the right and left side. And for women, if they have a stroke in this area, right, in the language area, only about 80% of them on the left side seem to be really, about 80% of women, about 20% of women can eventually, they get more, some of them actually use the right side as a language area also, right, okay? So there seems to be more connectivity in women, right? Now these areas, like Broca's area on the left, and equivalent area on the right, similarly, language area on the left, language area on the right, what does the right side do?
Right side, mechanical,
yeah.
Art,
geographic. Yes, but when it comes to the language area on the right, what does it do? It adds more emotion to your language, okay? Or you interpret, if you're interpreting it in the language era, right? You interpret the emotion of somebody speaking. And when you're speaking, you speak with more emotion, okay? The left side seems to be more, the right side seems to contribute more to the emotion of the receptive language as well as speaking the language, right? Okay? So the both sides, and that's why the corpus callosum is there, because it combines both sides together, right? Okay? Shall I leave the rest for you, Pat? Shall I leave the rest for you? Alright, let me just go through this area again. Just see if I can find another one to show you the Heschel's teres. It's only been popular, it's been used so much, okay? But anterior part here, here we go. We can see that gyrus running across here.
Yeah.
Alright, that transverse gyrus, that's Heschel's gyrus here. And if it's posterior to it, we see a plane error. What's that called? Planum terminale, okay? Planum temporale. So this is Heschel's gyrus, okay? And planum temporale is more of the association of auditory cortex. And all along this area, and even supramarginal gyrus and angular gyrus, all of that is an auditory association area. Okay? So if we have infarct in this area, what might we expect? So what do we call that? We can speak well, but we can't hear well, so we call that receptive aphasia. Receptive aphasia. Okay, so expressive aphasia, when the Broca's area goes, and when the language area goes, you can't understand the language, but you still probably speak it, but that's called receptive. The one will obviously affect the other, because if you can't hear it well, you won't be able to speak it. It's called receptive aphasia. Right. I think it's midday, and I think Dr. Lodenke, most of the class is gone. So just remember, primary cortex is the sensory and motor areas, and